to worry anymore. Amen. Wonderful truth. Psalms 23. Psalms 23. I'll have you tell you, turn to the most familiar passage in Scripture and see where you went. Amen. Psalms 23 is that place for tonight. And I'm going to try to stick to the first two verses. And as we look at this great psalm, we'll probably spend then 2 or 3 weeks here, depending on how the Lord leads, just breaking down this wonderful passage of Scripture. And what a blessing it is. A blessing it is. So much can be said about the 23rd Psalm. Most of you have been able to recite it since a little kid. So many wonderful truths bring so much comfort to a sorrowful heart. But I believe it's good for us tonight. Amen. It's good for the mature Christian. It's good for us to look into. I do believe it's important for us to understand a couple of things before we get into the Psalms, and just before we stand to read it together, let me just mention kind of a little bit of foundational work, and I want to read something to you, and we'll stand to read the text. Psalm 23 falls in a group of Psalms that is very precious, and if you just look at the one before it, Psalm 22, and the Psalm after it, it's a precious piece of what is called Hebrew poetry. And in Psalm 22, if you want to go back and read that tonight, we have the picture of our Lord Jesus Christ as the Good Shepherd, as he's referred to there in Psalm 22. And it's a clear prophecy of the crucifixion of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And especially this time of year, when it's just celebrating the resurrection here in Psalm 22, it's a good picture of the crucifixion. And then, if you could jump to Psalm 24, it portrays the Lord Jesus as the chief shepherd. So you have the good shepherd in 22, the chief shepherd in 24. And what is laid out for us there is he is pictured as a king coming in all power and glory. Well, I look forward to that day, amen. And so Psalms 22 gives us the prophecy of the crucifixion. I mean, you can read the words there. It's so intimate. It certainly will serve your heart. And then Psalms 24, he's pictured as the king coming in power and glory. So sandwiched in between of those two great psalms, we have Psalm 23. And I believe it's important for us to understand the contextual idea behind Psalm 23 before we go into it. Because the psalm, of course, is one of the most well-known and beloved psalms of the entire Bible, or passages of the entire Bible. And in Psalms 23, of course, he's pictured as the great shepherd. So we have the good shepherd, the great shepherd, the chief shepherd. So let me read this to you to drive that point home a little bit further, and we'll stand and read our passage for tonight. Psalm 22 pictures the death of Jesus. His death is the event which made it possible for us to be saved. Psalms 24 pictures the end of the age when the king himself will reign in perfect righteousness. On that day, those who have not been washed in his blood and saved by his grace will reign with him. But between the time we get saved and the day we go home to heaven, there is a life to live. That is where Psalm 23 comes in to play. It comes after Psalms 22 on purpose, and it's only because of Psalms 22 that makes Psalms 23 so comforting. That's a mouthful, but I thought that was a good read that I wanted to pass on to you, because we look back at what Jesus did. We look forward to what he's going to do when he comes in all power and glory, but what about the here and now? That's why we have Psalms 23, and it's very helpful to us. So let's stand together if you have that. So this psalm is one used at many funerals to comfort a sorrowful heart, and that, by the way, that's certainly very appropriate. But I want you to know tonight this psalm focuses on what Jesus does for us. I like the phrase in the passage, not just at death, but all during our life. And so, although it's appropriate at the ending of someone's life, that final chapter can certainly bring comfort to our heart, it is certainly appropriate and applicable for us tonight of all ages, especially to mature Christians. I was visiting somebody, one of our families this week, and we were talking about a bunch of stuff, and they said, man, I don't know how we got to talk about the Bible, but they said, man, I remember, and they named Brother Larry and one other pastor, man, they used to have us hold up our Bibles in church. You got your Bibles, they were holding up. They said, I really like that, so I'm going to try that tonight. Okay, I don't know if you got yours or not, but I was inspired by one of them. If you got the Word of God, copy of the Word, hold it up, hold it up. And praise the Lord, man, praise the Lord. Can't properly come to church without the book, amen? And I don't know, does anybody remember the other preacher that used to do that? Who was it? Brother Larry, and then they named one more, and that name slipped my mind. It's like, maybe it was him. So maybe I need to start doing that more often, to hold up the copy of the Word of God. I know we live in a digital age, And you've never heard me say anything about that as far as banning it, so to speak. I personally will always carry a copy of the Word of God. I do believe using digital Bibles, by the way, and this is another message for another time, right, preachers? But the paper now, not the Word of God, okay, but the paper that is printed on is no more inspired than a screen, okay? The Word of God is inspired, amen? And it is God's Word. But do be careful. I think a temptation for the digital readers is that you get distracted, right? There's so much more on that phone you can do. So if you do use that as a Bible, just put a safeguard up. Don't let the devil tempt you to do other things while you're doing that. We're going to do something I don't think I've done with you since I've been here. It's a familiar psalm, and I'm going to kind of read a responsive reading. I'm going to read the first verse. I want you as a congregation to read the second. I'll read the third. You read the fourth, and so forth to the end of the chapter. Let's do that, and let this dear passage speak to our hearts tonight. Psalms 23, beginning in verse 1. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Thou preparest the table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Father, we love you. And Lord, we're so thankful for this beloved passage, the truth that it carries for us here tonight. We know that there's many scenes that it's used in to bring comfort to our sorrowing souls. But Lord, I pray tonight, Lord, it'll do the same. And I pray, Lord, for us as mature Christians, the Wednesday night crowd, Lord, we'll look into this passage and see what it is you promise, see what it is you provide for us as the chief shepherd, the great shepherd. So God, stir our hearts tonight, challenge us, draw us closer, Lord, hide me behind the cross. I want everyone, people to see me. We want all eyes on you, and I pray that you'll speak through me, God, my thoughts, my words. Lord, man, as I speak to the outer body tonight, would you speak to the inner soul? And Lord, just challenge us in a special way. We love you and thank you for the privilege to serve you and preach your word. It's in your son's precious name we do pray. Amen. Thank you for standing. You may be seated. Psalm 23, you read that first verse, the Lord is my shepherd. Tonight I'm speaking to you on the comfort of the shepherd, the comfort of the shepherd. And really, you get to that first phrase, the Lord is my shepherd, and you just want to plop there and preach a lot. Because you could preach at least one good message on just that phrase, if not more. But as I go through and as I unfold on this passage, of course, you know, if no one had a biblical knowledge of what I'm about to tell you already, they would certainly get it from this passage alone. But we know that the shepherd and the sheep example is given to us all throughout Scripture. But as I come here, and I noticed that the Lord, we don't think we often stop to think, but he could have compared us to anything in the world. Right? From the animal kingdom, he could have compared us to anything in the world. A few examples. He could have said, my people are like bears because they're big and strong. He could have said, my people are like lions because they're courageous and they're fearless and they're brave. He could have said, my people are like foxes because they are so shrewd and so wise. He could have even said, my folks are like doves because they are peaceful and meek. But you notice that the Lord didn't give any of those animals to describe us. He simply says here in this text and in other passages, he says that we are sheep. He calls us sheep. He refers to himself as the shepherd. And as you already know, sheep are not the brightest animals in the animal kingdom. Amen? But I believe it does us good to really see how the Lord classifies us, if you will. He didn't call us any of those other animals. And when you look at sheep, one man said accurately, he said they are dumb and they are defenseless. They require a shepherd to care for them. They require a shepherd to protect them. They require someone who will look after their smallest needs and who will lead them to where they need to be. They are ignorant, needy, wayward, and frightened. And the Lord called us sheep. Amen? Doesn't serve our egos too much, does it? But I believe whether we like the reading of what the Lord says or not, obviously, it is 100% accurate.
He didn't make a mistake when he called us a sheep and himself the shepherd rather than calling us one of those other things. And I've got this in my notes here because I believe it's good for us to realize before we move on, but I believe this is what often gets us in trouble today in the flock of God. I believe a lot of our troubles come, Brother God, because we forget that we are sheep. A lot of times, Brother, we want to be the parent. Big and strong, loud, for everybody to hear and see. And a lot of times we want to be like the lion, but everybody thinks we're courageous and we're fearless and we're brave and we're going through the darkest corner of the world and take on any foe that's there. We won't paint a picture of like a false where people think we're very shrewd and very wise and crafty in what we do. But God can't compare us to any of those animals. He compares us to sheep, and I believe we get ourselves in a mess when we try to be these other things or come off as something different. God simply called us sheep. And listen, in Eastern culture, you know the story behind on the comparison here. The only time sheep would get hurt is when they did not follow the shepherd. So what a message to me and to you this evening in guarding our own lives. Hey, listen, if we want to stay in line with God, if we want to stay protected in His will, then let's just follow the shepherd. Let's just accept what He's labeled us as, knowing that He knows a lot better than we do. And let's just say we're sheep. We're not bears, we're not lions, we're not tigers or lions. We're simply sheep. And let's be what God calls us to be. So since these sheep are totally reliant on the shepherd, it makes them, as we transition here, it makes them very needy. And because they're very needy, there's a special bond that takes place between the shepherd and the sheep. He's required to get to know them very intimately. He knows the ones who are prone to wander. He knows the ones who are weaker. He knows the ones who are loyal. He knows all of his sheep by name. And weeks to come, we'll look at even times where in Eastern culture, the shepherd would pull the sheep over and just speak to them and whisper to them and it would calm them down. It's just an awesome picture of what the shepherd is able to do and provide for the sheep. By the way, although they're ignorant and all those other adjectives that one man accurately describes sheep as, they know the shepherd's voice. Although they don't know direction, a dog gets lost and he finds his way back home. A sheep gets lost and he's lost. So I look talks about leaving the 99 and going to find the one because he's not getting back on his own. But although he's got all these things fiction against him, they know the voice of the shepherd. They know his sound. They know his smell. There's a bond between the sheep and the shepherd that you just can't find anywhere else in the world. So tonight, I want us to focus on, I don't even have points for you tonight, so we're just going to go verse by, so we'll look at these verses, we're going to try to get to the first two tonight. I want to give you two words that I believe we see here as we begin this passage, and you can almost look at this six verses and break them down so many different ways, but think about these two words, relationship and provision. From verse 1 and 2, let's think about relationship and provision. First of all, notice David identifies the object of his love. I'm telling you, I love this first phrase. The Lord is my shepherd. The Lord, if you look in your Bible there, you got all caps for that. It's Jehovah God, the great I am. And I believe there's a lot of difference between when David wrote this. Commentary say when he was young, commentary say when he was old, commentary say he was maybe even singing it when he went to fight Goliath going through the valley. Regardless of when he wrote it, we look back to this, and it reminded all the people of what God had done for them. The great I am, the great Jehovah God, the God of creation, the God of salvation, the God of eternity, the one and only true God, the Lord is my shepherd. What an encouragement that is. All the many names of the Lord that David could have used to magnify him in this passage. He was led by the Spirit to sing about Jehovah Rahi, the Lord is my shepherd. Why is that? Because it gives us the image of a shepherd tenderly leading, tenderly feeding, and caring for his sheep. It's the perfect picture, if you will, of our precious Savior's relationship to his sheep. jot this reference down. We won't go there tonight for the sake of time, but the image of himself as a shepherd was a favorite of the Lord. And you see that in John chapter 10, the Gospel of John chapter 10. Of course, we looked at that in our study through John. But jot that down. Read that chapter tonight sometime this week. I believe it will encourage your soul. So second of all, I want you to notice not only about the Lord, Jehovah God, the great I am, but notice as when the psalm begins, David is writing in first person. It seems as though he is talking to us about the shepherd, and in doing so, he uses, I like this, possessive personal pronouns. The Lord is, I don't like that. He could have said the Lord is your shepherd. He could have said the Lord is our shepherd. He could have even went further and said the Lord is the shepherd, or the Lord is our shepherd, but he didn't say any of those, did he? He said the Lord is my shepherd, possessive, personal. And you think about that, the great I am, great Jehovah God, God of creation and salvation, and all those other things, and he's my shepherd, the Lord God. What a wonderful blessing that is. Instead, David tells us that it's a personal relationship with the shepherd. And I love those words underlined, if you don't mind marking your Bible, the Lord is my shepherd. And he makes it very personal here. I praise God that when I got saved, listen, I got more than just a Savior, amen? I got a shepherd. I got a shepherd, and he's my shepherd. I don't have to look to somebody else and depend upon somebody else. I can go to the shepherd. When my life gets a little restless, it's the shepherd. It's my shepherd that pulls me aside and whispers to my ear and keeps my spirit settled and keeps me on the right path and keeps my eyes on the path. It's going to lead me to the righteousness he talks about later in the passage. My shepherd. He cares about us. He loves us. Just think about this. He tends to our every need. He leads us. He guides us. He's patient with us. He corrects us. Some of these things are things that we'll look at in the following weeks as we go down through these verses. But praise God, when I got saved, I met one who put us at the top of the priority list. And I'm thankful for that. Then notice, thirdly, David tells us as a result of this personal relationship, he is confident that the shepherd will take care of his needs. The first verse goes on to read, the Lord is my shepherd. Then what does the psalmist say? I shall not. He is 100% confident that his shepherd that he's describing here, talking about, will meet all of his needs. What a wonderful truth that is. How applicable that is to you and I today. He says, I shall not want. The fact the rest of the psalm is the development of that very thought, how God leads and provides and is very needed, even protects them in times of need. But listen, Jesus is very adequate to meet every and any need you have in your life tonight. Regardless of what it is, regardless of what I face, regardless of what you face, regardless of what David would face, God is more than able to meet your need. He's more than able to provide you with the strength and the wisdom that you need to face whatever it is you're going to face tomorrow. He's more than enough. And we're reminded that the good shepherd, he takes his sheep into places where we can feed on the best grass. He provides for us. He leads us. He guides us. He takes us to the still waters that we'll look at here momentarily. And he gives us what we need to keep us refreshed in him. Well, I'm thankful he can provide for every day. I'm thankful that as a child of God, I'm thankful as a little sheep that says he is my shepherd, that I know I'll never go lacking. Now let's just throw this out there. He'll always give us what we need. Not our wish list, but the things we want. Let's be careful. Let's be careful not to accuse God. You provide this for me. God, I needed this in my life. It really is a one. Sometimes I think we thank God for things we don't have. He'll give us everything we need. And I heard one man say this week, if he doesn't get it to you, then he probably didn't need it. What a humbling thought that is. God will provide all of our needs, and we know we could go to countless places in Scripture to support that and back that up. David's saying, hey, whoever belongs to the Lord, they just know you're going to be well cared for. You're going to be tended to. He's going to guide you. He's going to lead you. He's going to love on you. He's going to meet the needs. Oh, thank God we have a shepherd of a soul that meets our needs, that leads us, that guides us. And what an intimate picture that is. So the first verse there, we see the Lord, Jehovah God, is my shepherd, his personal, his possessive. He's going to meet all of our needs. But I want you to look at the second verse with me tonight. The Bible says, he maketh me to lie down in green pastures.
He leadeth me beside still waters.
He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. I want to share with you that I came across this week. You know, it's not easy for a sheep to lie down. When you study the flocks and the sheep of the Eastern culture, it's not always easy for a sheep to lay down. In fact, there's several things. A strange thing about sheep is they'll refuse to even lie down unless four requirements are met. Let me give them to you quickly. First of all, they must be free from all fear. Okay? We've already noted that sheep are very defenseless. Okay? So they live apart from the shepherd. Let me just throw that in there. They live in constant fear. Anything that could sneak up on them in the grass that they're grazing in, it creates a fear in their heart. So they will not lie down unless they are free from all fear. Number two, they will not lie down unless there must be no tension between members of the flock, other sheep. Okay, if they feel like one's bumping and tension is, but they won't lay down. Again, that relates back to the fear that's in their own heart of what's going to happen if I lay down. Am I going to be taking advantage of those kind of things? Number three, they will not lie down unless they must not be activated with flies or parasites. So that's something simple, but something that bothers the sheep to the point that they will not lie down in the green pastures as mentioned here in verse 2. And then the last one is they must be free of hunger. I find this interesting, but they must be free of hunger. Sheep will not rest until they are free of hunger. A hungry sheep is always on its feet, searching for something else to put in its mouth. Now, to be as classified by many and most commentators and just reality, to be a dumb animal that they are, that's a pretty good instinctive there, isn't it? Some pretty good guards they have in place that will not allow them to lie down until these things are met. So the shepherd is the one that provides for them and leads them to the green pastures. Now look back. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He, the shepherd, maketh me, the sheep, to lie down in green pastures. Now if you wrote down those four things you can remember, just play those back over in your mind. Any gnats ever fly around to cause you not to be at peace? Huh? Any problems arise that cause a little rustle in your soul where you don't feel like you can just lie down and be relaxed and be at ease, aggravated by different things, bothered by different things? We preached about this several weeks ago Sunday morning in our Victorious Christian Living series, fear that grips our heart. How so many of us live in fear from day to day, worried about what the things that happen. Listen, claim the promise that gives tonight. He will make us to lie down in green pastures. And I read briefly this week, and maybe we'll touch on it more in further weeks, but that there's on occasion sometimes the shepherd would even have to take his staff, pull the legs of the sheep for their own safety, to get them just to lay down, get them just to stop a little bit. Because the shepherd knows there's danger. The sheep doesn't know that. The shepherd does. Aren't you thankful? We have a shepherd of our souls that can sometimes use that staff and just pull our legs back a little bit. We need to slow down sometimes spiritually. We get so busy, we get so golden, sometimes I think the shepherd just has to say, hey, just dwell right here in this green pasture. You don't see the collision in here. You don't see this over here. You don't see the danger that's lurking over here that we even read about in verse 4. So sometimes he slows us down. He makes us to lie down in green pasture. He also, see, this is a flock that is free from any disturbances. Sheep are very easily frightened. I mean, I read several times just one jackrabbit jumping around from behind a bush can cause an entire flock to go into a stampede. Just one. I mean, frightened by every little move, by anything they're not expecting that catches them off guard. They are frightened by that. I believe we can start understanding the relation that we see that the comparisons that are there and made throughout the Word of God. When one sheep is frightened and begins to run, it's told that the rest of them soon follow behind. Following in blind fear. Not knowing what caused it, not knowing what's ahead, but just in fear, following.
going along with the one sheep that was bothered. But nothing quiets a flock of sheep like seeing their shepherd in the field. Man, you can read story after story of shepherds that have written about their experiences in this type of setting. How a flock would be disturbed and how a flock would be bothered and how a shepherd, you and I might not be able to tell, but how a shepherd could walk upon a flock and know immediately that many of the sheep were frightened, many of them were scared, many, but just the presence of the shepherd would calm the flock down. What is that, a wonderful spiritual truth? How do you know the presence of the shepherd just calms our souls right now? What a wonderful truth that is. Sometimes we get rattled just like the sheep. Sometimes we run in fear just like the sheep. Sometimes we're bothered by a little noise in the bushes just like the sheep. But if we'll realize the presence of the shepherd, he's the one that keeps everything in perspective. He's the one that keeps the sheep from running to a point where maybe they even go off the side of a cliff and bring bodily harm to their own bodies. Like sheep, though, we are so easily frightened. We live in an uncertain life. Any hour that we live in today could bring disaster. We've talked about before how it could be a phone call, something that happens tomorrow, and you know, the unknown and the unexpected things in our life, they do bring an element of fear to our life. I believe it's just good for us to own up to that, be honest, and to admit that those things do bring fear to our life, but nothing quiets our soul knowing the shepherd's there. Nothing brings comfort to the heart of a Christian than knowing the shepherd's there. You know, there may be times in your life, in my life, that the shepherd has to pull us aside and just speak to us in a still small voice, but watch it. Just to calm us down. Just kind of bring us back around. To keep us from running off, getting off the path that we'll look at next time we're together in this passage and running into danger. All to listen to his still small voice. All to know that his presence is what keeps our soul at ease. His presence is what brings the quietness to our soul. When our Lord is with us, suddenly things are not as bad as nearly as they seemed originally. 1 Timothy 1:7, you know the verse, God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of sound mind. I just tell you tonight, we can claim that verse. And we must not fear. Shepherd is near. I like how that fits together. We as Christians, we as the sheep, we as the flock must not fear when the shepherd is near. And one of the truth that is, and one I want us to claim and to help bring comfort to our hearts. Let me quickly move on to that last phrase, verse 2. Not only does he cause us to lie down in green pasture, but it says he leadeth me beside the still waters. He also leads us beside the still waters. Sheep, not only do they need to eat, but they need water to survive. Aaron, being the animal they are, they cannot drink from any turbulent river. They cannot drink from any fast-moving water. They will not drink from any water that's creating a loud noise by maybe coming over the rocks. They will not go to it. So the shepherd knows that not only do they need to eat and graze in the fields, but they need water. They need fresh water. And so many times as the shepherd is overseeing the flock and as he is leading them and guiding them and providing for them and taking care of them, he will go and he'll take rocks, as it were, stones from the riverbed, and he'll dam up a stream. He'll put them all the way across so that water then does what? Slows down. It stops. Because he knows his sheep are not going to drink from the fast-flowing water. They're not going to drink from the rapids. They're not going to drink from the turbulent waters that are going down the stream. So he'll take these rocks and he'll build it across, build a dam across the stream there. And he'll build it up so that they can drink from the still waters. Isn't that a wonderful provision of the shepherd? Isn't that a wonderful picture of what God often does for us? The shepherd temporarily does that to the stream so the water becomes still and the sheep can drink. And listen, Jesus has made it abundantly clear that he is the water for our thirsty souls. I'm telling you, so many people in our community, so many people in today's society, they're thirsting for something, aren't they, church? And they're looking for something else. Their life is empty, and although they have this and that, and they have far more materialistic things than you and I have, or maybe we'll ever have, but yet they're still thirsting, they're still longing, they're still looking for something. And I love what we find in John 7:37, the Bible says, if any man thirst, let him come to me and drink.
I'm telling you, whether as a believer we need a fresh drink tonight, or someone comes to our mind and says, man, I just don't need to drink the living water, amen, as he told the woman of the well, I'll give you living water where you're never thirst again. But maybe we're a little dry tonight, maybe in our own spiritual walk with God, our own devotions with him, our own desire for more of him, maybe we become a little dry, and God just says to us tonight, listen, I'm going to make the waters still so that you can come back to the brook, you can come back to the stream, you can come back to the river and drink the water that you need for your thirsting soul.
I'm thankful he provides that. So thankful no matter what your need is tonight, he'll quench your thirst. Amen. He'll quench your thirst. It was a sprite that had the muscle of running for a long time. Something to the effect of quench your thirst, maybe. Obey your thirst, quench your thirst, something like that. But listen, there's nothing in this world that can quench the thirsting soul like Jesus, like the Great Shepherd. So whatever's lacking in your life, whatever's missing in your life, whatever fuse that's blowing, it's just not making a connection, come to the waters tonight. Lay down in the green pasture. Realize everything's going to be okay because the Shepherd is leading us, guiding us. He's protecting us. He's providing we can have comfort in the Great Shepherd. Father, we love you. And Lord, we thank you for these wonderful truths, Lord, just unfolding to